Daddy, buy me one of those sexy girls that wear no clothes. I don't want a car or a truck. All I want to do is... Hi there, it's Maya Knife again. And yeah, yes, you guessed it. That was the 60 subscriber dance. Woohoo! Oh, looks like I have some visitors. Come for the party. Yeah, yeah. It's flaming hot action here, eh? Yeah, yeah. Guess that indeed. I'm over 60 subscribers now. Picked up 10 subscribers over the course of the last week. I mean, pretty soon I'll be as popular as Edward Snowden at the NSA Christmas party. And don't worry. I won't keep dancing every time I get 10 subscribers. At least not if I get to 100. If I manage to get to 100, then I'll cut it back. I'll maybe only dance every 12 subscribers or something. We'll see. Well, a couple of things I wanted to do today. Today I want to be an exploration, but first things first is it occurred to me in between sessions that there was something down here. Oops, actually, I should make sure I've got everything I need before I go down there. For example, I do not need this. And I need... Oh, is that the only pick I've got? Ooh. Okay, so I'll probably have to make myself a new pick, but I can still show you what I want to show you. Anyway, down here, something occurred to me. When I first hollowed out the what I call the Nexus room down below, if you'll remember, I got trace readings of magnetite all over the place, all over that room there. And then I went hunting it down, and I found that magnetite deposit, that small deposit that we found, and I hollowed it out. Well, what occurs to me is the Pro Pick, Prospector's Pick, only detects up to 12 away. And if we look down here, let's see, so where are we at here? It's the rightmost of those two numbers, so 636. So 636. So the closest that we found any was here at 56, which is like 20 away. So now, as I recall, you might recall that I said that there's still a couple of, still some trace amounts down here. Actually, I don't know if I mentioned that or not. There's still some trace amounts I didn't feel like chasing down, but still, if I'm still getting, if like in the middle of this room, where's my prospector's pick? If in the middle of this room I'm still getting trace amounts, it might mean that there's actually another, see, traces of hematite. Traces of hematite all the way over here. So that says to me that there might actually be another hematite deposit down here. So I think the first thing I'm going to do today, and I'll do it off camera, is I'm going to try and track those down just to see if there is indeed another hematite deposit around here. And maybe it'll be, I forgot to turn that off again. And maybe it'll be a bigger one. And maybe we might even run into some cassiterite or some bismuthinite while we're hunting for it. And that would allow us to get ourselves finally into the Bronze Age. So I'm going to do that off camera and then meet you back here when I'm done. See you then. Welcome back for just a brief moment here. I was making myself up some new tool heads for new picks that I'm going to need to try and mine down there. And I decided to show you something interesting, useful. So I've poured out the tool heads that I had molds for, but I've still got 1,300 units of copper here, molten copper in this ceramic vessel here. And I got no tool heads poured in, so it's just going to go cold on me. Now, I can obviously pour it into these rectangular molds, these ingot molds that I have waiting for me here. But the same thing's going to happen to them. As you can see, this one's brilliant white, but they're going to cool down while they sit in my inventory, or if I put them on the floor, or if I do anything else with them for that matter. But there is something we can do about that. So let's just finish pouring out these last two here. Shame I don't have more molds so I could empty this thing, but it's still good enough to demonstrate the point. And there's the last one. Okay. So, I don't know if this, if this will work or not. Oh, that's interesting. Well, we'll see if it works there. Anyway, if you put molds in the forge here in this side area here, the stuff that's in them doesn't cool off. It stays at whatever temperature it was at. So I can put those three ingots or molds full of molten copper in there, and they'll stay molten. They'll stay at whatever temperature. I actually don't know if it'll work with a ceramic vessel full of liquid stuff, so it'll be interesting how that works. Okay. Now, I still have three here that I haven't been able to do anything with, so but there's something we can do about that, too. So remember these two basalt blocks I picked up? I'll just use one for now. And they're raw basalt stone, and I picked them up because basalt's hard enough that I can make a stone anvil out of it. So let's put that down for now. Now, I can't... We don't have all the things necessary yet to actually start using an anvil as an anvil. That doesn't mean that we can't put it to use at all. So let's just make a little hammer here. Stone hammer. So we can turn that guy into a stone anvil. So as I noted once, showed you once before, you right click on top of stone hammer, well, with any kind of a hammer, and do click it again, right click it again, and then put the hammer in there, and now it's it'll stay an anvil until I take that hammer out. Well, these both are input slots here, and this, well, I guess you can't see it because my cursor probably doesn't show up here, but anyways, so this is an input slot, and so are these and these, and the same thing is true of an anvil. In the input slots, you can put hot items in there, including liquid metal and stuff like that, and they'll keep their temperature. So we can do that there. Now, this guy here is not, this slot here is not, won't take a molten, you know, won't take an ingot or a mold or anything like that, because its purpose is for a plan that you use for, the plan that describes the shape that you're going to hammer out. So that's not what that's for. And this is also all for plan, I'm sorry, this is also for plans over here, so you can't put anything there, and this is for something else as well. So only these three spots here are input slots that'll keep things warm for you. So like I said, it'll be interesting to see what happens with my ceramic vessel full of copper here. Oh, no, it cooled off. Yeah, you can see now if I'm right-clicking on it and I don't get anything, and it doesn't tell me it's molten anymore. So... Putting them in here, putting a vessel in here doesn't keep it warm, but these guys, as you can see, are still retaining their heat. So that's one thing you can do if you have, you know, more liquid metal than you have molds to use, is tool molds to use. You can throw them into these rectangular molds and then pop them into either the forge or into a waiting anvil. And this is true not just of stone anvils, but all anvils. They have those three input slots that'll keep things warm. Okay, well, I'll bring you back in after I'm done my exploratory mining. Bye for now. Okay, welcome back. So I've been doing a bit of mining, as you can see. So what I did was, since I have all these like little trace readings of hematite, is I found this one here was giving me a trace reading, this block, trace reading hematite. And the reason that's important is it's 13 away from the ceiling that you can see up there. So that means that since the radius of the propic is like 12 or 12 and a half, depending on how you want to measure it, that means that the whatever hematite this reading was picking up on has to be below that ceiling. So I started doing branch mining out to a radius of 12 in all directions and up to that ceiling, right? And once I'd done that, then I would have to go down 12 as well if I still hadn't found anything. Now, fortunately, this is the same area that I was doing mining out the tetrahedrite, and it's the same area also I was doing the other hematite before, so I didn't have to do all this from scratch, but I still had to do a lot of mining. And after all of that, I found one hematite ore, hanging out in some of the... And some of the phyllite, which is this pinker stuff up here. Whoops. Which way do I want to go out of here? Oh, I don't want to go either of those ways. I want to go this way. Okay, so when I picked up that one, then a lot of the trace readings I was getting out here in the branch mining area disappeared, because that was what they were picking up on. But the trace readings I was getting back here in my Nexus area were still there, which meant there were still some bits of hematite somewhere. So I dug out in that direction, this direction, and down there, and I dug down there, chasing this thing around, and over here. And I eventually found the last few pieces. Oops, the last few pieces down here in the basalt. And they were scattered around. This is tetrahedrite right here, not hematite. And I was like, one there, one down toward the end there, and another one in here. So, or actually, I think it was over here. So after about 2.5, maybe 3 hours of my time mining, my total haul of hematite was a big 4. So that's why, if you'll remember, I said in an earlier video that it's generally not worth it to go chasing after traces of ores, and that's why, because you spend a lot of time, you don't generally get a whole lot for it. So you go looking to see if you can get a larger signal, but if you just, you know, if you've gone 12 in each direction from a trace and all you're still getting are traces, then just give up on it. Odds are you're just looking at little bits and pieces scattered around. It's not going to be worth your time to pick it up. So, but the only reason I did it in this case was just basically as a demonstration to show you that how much effort can be involved in chasing these things down. What else was there? Oh, yeah. So in all of this here, all this mining that I did, looking around, I did not pick up any traces of cassiterite, which is the tin we need to make regular bronze, or bismuthinite, which is the ore we need to make bismuth bronze. So still can't make bronze. The only thing I did find was when I was digging down here for other readings, is I found this cave system down here. Ran into it. So I haven't explored it at all because I figure that'll be fun to do on camera at some later time, since the odds of me dying are high. And I still haven't died yet. So, you know, the entertainment value of the series just isn't up to par unless I've died a few times, I'm sure. So we'll try that out later. Anyway, so I'm going to finish my preparations. I think there should still be plenty of time here to go out and actually do some explorating. And so that's what we're going to do. Back in a bit. Okay, well, I took the evening to make myself some new tools. I got myself a new sword, a couple new picks. This one's about to die. And a new pro pick. And filled up one of these ceramic vessels, has some extra stuff in it, like my hammer and chisel. And I tended my crops, although there's a little bit more still to be done. And since I tended to them last night, now half the barley has come in, but we'll deal with that later. Anyway, look over here. Our first sow had its litter, and half the pigs were born outside the fence. Probably a similar sort of thing will happen when the sheep have their lambs, I guess. Lambs? Yeah, lambs. Baby sheep. Okay. All right. So let's pick a direction. What's a good direction? Let's go in this direction. So the goal here is to find some stuff that we're missing. We want to go and see if we can find some cassiterite or bismuthinite. Pumpkins here, they'll come in handy if we find any chickens, which is another thing we're looking for. Oh, do I remember I went in this direction once before and it very quickly dead ends, doesn't it? Oh, there's a pig. I could kill you for your leather. Yeah. Some other time. Other things would be useful to find would be willows. Be nice to find willows. It would make our wood collection for making charcoal a little bit easier. And also stick collection using the scythe. Let's see, what other things should we keep an eye out for? Pumpkins would be one of them, but as we just noted there, there's pumpkins pretty close. Is there any land out there? No? Okay. Well, let's quickly take this guy down. Do-do-do-do-do-do. Yeah, so I'm thinking of doing a let's play of Kerbal Space Program at some point. I don't have it yet, but I was just playing around with, I downloaded the demo version a while back actually, and it wasn't working. for me. I mean, the game itself more or less worked. Oh, I need the saw. There we go. But in the dialogues, none of the buttons had any text or anything like that. And there were some, in the forum, there were some answers for how to deal with that. I guess I need another one. And the most of them dealt with versions of Linux that I'm not using. But I eventually found one that worked for me, and I finally got the text up. So now that I know that it'll actually work properly on my Linux system, I'm a little more inclined to try using it. Or play with it. So I'm a little more inclined to buy the full game, because I want to play campaign, which is the more interesting version of it. So I might give that a try. And I've watched a few, like I said, I've done a little bit of the demo game, and I've watched a few videos, but other than that, I'm an utter noob. So I think I'll just, if I do it, I'll just record myself from the very start so you can see all my crashes and explosions and see how many Kerbals I murder in my attempts to get into space. So, what are some other games I got my eyes on? Timber and Stone is another one. Unfortunately, that's not available for Linux, but I do have it for OS X, the Mac. And that's one that I just die in all the time. It's just a little landmass, or is it, ooh, this is significant. Well, let's pull in here and have a look. Oh, it didn't break, though. How rare. Yeah, something I've noticed with a boat. Yeah, see how far out I am now when I was originally right near land? The server and the client get out of sync as to where the boat actually is the longer you travel. So I may now permanently lost that boat. We'll see. So I forgot to do it this time, but what you generally have to do is like basically log out of the session, log out of the game and log back in just before you want to get out of the boat, and then it will update to the correct location. What's this, shale? Okay, well, let's see what's in this location here. But yeah, Timber and Stone is kind of interesting. There's more combat to it than I would like. I mean, there's no way to avoid the combat. There's no peaceful mode in Timber and Stone. And it's sort of kind of clearly geared towards forcing you into combat. And just recently, the developer, because a few loudmouths, I would call them, were complaining that it was too easy, the developer made it a lot harder by throwing a lot more mobs in combat. So that actually, to me, made the game worse. But there's still a lot to it that's I find really interesting. I kind of like the game mechanics, so I might do a let's play with that. But basically, I suck at it. I die early. Where's home? Home is all that way, right? So let's proceed into these mountains. See what we find. And I have a bed with me, so that when night falls, we do not have to deal with the heebly greeblies. Oh yeah, this is a significant landmass here. Well, it wasn't very far to travel at all. But we haven't found anything we like yet. Come on, server, catch up. What was that rock? Nothing. Yeah, there was another one. Can I remember the name of it without going and looking in the web browser? No, I cannot. There's another one where you basically you build your own medieval village, and as near as I can tell, there's no combat at all in that one, which is great by me. And he has some really great, the AI stuff looks really great in it, but he doesn't even have, as far as I know, doesn't even have a demo version out. He just every now and then releases his testing videos of him testing the gameplay. I'll try and post a link to it if I remember, and once I'm done recording the video. But yeah, in general, I kind of like games where you... I was going to say build things, but not build in the sense of, you know, there are builders in Minecraft who build fantastic structures and all this sort of stuff. But I like the... I like tech tree games, I guess, basically is how it is, you know, where you kind of have to bootstrap yourself up. You start with a very limited set of resources and capabilities, and then you use those to build up, you know, basically like Minecraft to some degree, Terraform to a much greater degree. Veteran Wolves is a bit like that, although I think he went a bit off the rails, and again, he got really more combat-oriented. Same sort of thing as he decided, oh, it was too easy, he's got to make it harder, and it seems when game designers run out of ideas, their idea of harder is just to throw more mobs at you, or make the mobs tougher. Okay. Oh, we haven't done too well here. I don't see any willows. We haven't seen any ores at all. Nothing. Not even the ores that we already have. Oh, some more pumpkins. Anyways, let's go around that way, just for the hell of it. Oh, yeah. Let's get that out of there so we can see if we pick up anything new. Wee pumpkins. Is there an easier way up here? Nope. Yeah, I think there's a grain I'm missing too, isn't there? I've got rice, I've got barley, I've got oats, I've got wheat. Oh, corn. I don't think I have corn. So if I... or maize, I guess. The correct name for it. Oh, lots of pumpkins here. So that's another thing I keep an eye out for. Maize. Come on, give me some. Yeah. Oh, I'm living in an... Oh, there we go, willows. I'm living in an ore-poor world. Oh, I should have brought a scythe with me. Oh, doesn't matter. Give me some willow saplings here. There's one. Like to get 10. Get 10 on the ground, and that's a really good start. I got 2. Really good start in our tree farm. Oh, these willows really don't want to give any. Don't want to give any their saplings up, do they? Oh, there's a third. I got a couple other ideas for videos I want to do. Won't be much of a series, it'll just be basically one very long session that I'll probably split into several videos, but another one I'd like to do is similar to this, but like I say, much shorter one, just the starting part to see how difficult it is to survive only on grains. Given how long it takes them to grow, like they're the slowest growing crops in the game. So, and they're also when you just eat the grain itself, you get very little. You get more for most of the vegetables, so you get very little of your hunger satisfied by that. Good man, I'm like hacking the tree apart, and I've only got 4 so far. So until I can get a quern and grind it up into flour and make bread, I'm just looking at eating these little bits and seeds of grain. So that might be pretty tough. And someone suggests I can make it even tougher on myself by increasing the length of the Terraform Craft year, which is kind of an intriguing idea, since the time it takes for crops to grow is basically based on the year length. Yeah, so if a crop, a given crop takes 4 months to grow. If the year is longer, then those 4 months will take longer to pass. So, but like I say, that would just be a short one, because once I get to the, basically once I get to the point where the first crop comes in, then I know I can survive at that point, and then it's just standard play, so there'd be no point in continuing it beyond that. So, well, I've got 8, and there's one more hiding up there, and that'll be enough for me. So let's lop the tree down here. See how much wood we get from it. Yeah, see, this is why we like willows. One willow tree, and we get probably a stack. Come on. There we go. Stack and a half, right? A stack and a quarter. Okay. It was a small willow. Where's home? I'm going away. Oh, I'm seizing up a lot here. Oh, because there's mountains around. Mountains always take forever to render. There we go. Home's that way. So I want to go this way. And I get this stuff out of my inventory. And then we'll continue along. And still looking for some cassiterite. And or bismuthinite. Come on, guys. Oh, yeah. I hate going through mountains for exactly this reason. Mountainous terrain is really laggy in TFC. Oh, no, that's just tetrahedrite. Or I got tetrahedrite. Don't need tetrahedrite. I got scads of it. My basement is filled with this stuff. Yeah, more tetrahedrite, yeah. We're only halfway through the day. Good. Don't need to pull out the bed yet. More tetrahedrite. It's a coppery world. Well, actually, I did find the hematite, didn't I? Ooh, there's a deer. Well, I guess I could kill the deer for leather. For its hide, sure. Won't we do that? Add a bit of spice to the game. Die, 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 die! Die, Bambi! Die! Oh! There we go. Bambi gave himself up for a good cause. We'll build a bellows out of his skin. Bambi was a her? Actually, it was Bambi a he or she. I don't actually know. Big eyelashes. Usually in the Disney world, that means a she. Okay. Good God. Nothing. Well, if this trip doesn't pan out, then the next thing we'll do investigate that cavern underneath the house, and assuming that we can evade the mobs long enough to actually see what's in it, maybe we'll find something down there. That's too high there. I don't want to go that way. But we did find our willow, so we found something, I guess. That's a start. That's the consolation prize. Let's come out this way. Actually, we must be getting on in the day. So, yeah, you're just another rock. Let's get a little bit higher where we can see the sun. Ah, yeah, he's getting down there. Was it like 1600? 1500. Yeah, okay, well, I found some native copper. Oh, now that. That is bismuthinite. That's the sort of thing we are looking for. Okay. Let's mark a waypoint before we die. And let's get rid of some of this crap that's clogging up our inventory. Don't need all this shale. Oops, want to keep my trees. I don't really need bones for anything. I can get more sticks. Don't need those rocks. Okay, we found some bismuthinite. More copper. Copper. More copper. Come on, don't be coy. You know you want to come out and play. Ooh, there's another one. Okay. Fortunately, I don't have to run around and collect enough to make make tools out of. I already have my tools. I just need enough to give me an idea of where the deposit is. But I think bedtime is upon me, so let's deal with that first, and then we can find the rest of the bismuthinite in the morning. Okay. Oh, I guess I should do something about food and water. Bread. Boom. And then a few veggies, you know, just to balance out our diet. Don't want to have too much starch in our diet. Leave us all logy. Okay. Wasn't there one there yet? Okay. Oh, it's all the crap I threw away. Okay, so we found one here and one up here. What about you? Nope. So it's probably under this hill somewhere. Yeah, there's another one. But whereabouts? It looks like it might be deep. No, that's tetrahedrite. Nope, not there. More tetrahedrite. So we got tetrahedrite to copper and bismuth all in the same, bismuthinite all in the same area. Let's come over this way a little bit. Nothing there, nothing there. Okay, there's one. And I'm pretty much ready to copper. Yeah, nice copper. Okay. So we found one guy up there. There and there. And then I think there was another one up there. So I'm thinking that it's going to be into this hill a bit and down. So why don't we just try digging straight down from here and see where we end up. And there it is. Let's get a little closer so you can see it. There's our bismuthinite. Right up in there. Took a while longer to find it than I was expecting, which is kind of surprising given that it's actually a large sample. So I think the problem was, remember how I said that I thought it was going to be up in the toward the mountain, because I wasn't getting any readings further out. Or not readings, I wasn't picking up any samples further out. I think that was wrong. And the reason we weren't picking up any samples, oh no, I want to hang on to that. Further out was just that we were instead picking up all that native copper and tetrahedrite instead. So anyway, so I'm in here now. It's not a very large deposit, but it's a large deposit, and I don't need all that much of it, really. Because in bismuth bronze, the amount of bismuth is very small. I think as low as 10% or something like that. I think it's 10 to 20%. So I'll mine this stuff out and then bring you back in when there's something more interesting to show you or to talk about. See you then. Well, I finished mining up all of the bismuthinite that was in there, and although it was a large deposit, there wasn't all that much. It's mostly sitting here, 16 and 7, so 23, another 16 there, 16 big ones, 23, 39, another 16 there, 40, 55, so that was it, 55, which is not bad. I mean, like I said, it's probably going to be plenty for me for for things I need to use it for. So just so that I don't end up completely exactly retracing my path on the way home, I first headed a bit to the west before then starting to head back north towards home. North or south? That doesn't matter. And man, I found tons of copper. Like, where is it in here? 17 native copper nuggets I found. What's the other one? And then I start running into a ton of sphalerite all over the place. I mean, I've got enough zinc now just from these little surface things to choke a galvanizing mill, but haven't seen any cassiterite at all. However, I haven't run into any more bismuthinite either. But I did, however, find something that was on the list, and here it is here, maize. So we can, I was thinking that would complete our grain collection, but actually I think we still need rye as well. I don't think I have rye. So I've been keeping an eye out for that, but I haven't seen any of that either. But, so we got one more thing. Oh, this is going to be, at least give me some seeds. Some seeds I get to keep for once. So anyway, so I thought I'd show you that. And if anything else exciting happens to come up on my journey home, I'll bring you in for it. See you later. And here I am, safely home from my journey. And the only bad thing happened was a skeleton managed to get me a shot in the back of the head as I landed the boat out there and just came across the water here, and a skeleton got shot off at me. But that's all. Didn't do me that much damage. Half a segment or whatever you want to call those things. Oh, and look, some boys have showed up too. Welcome me home. Hi, guys. Oh, good. I get more experience points. You stole my flower! Friggin' thief. Man, you guys have no respect for property rights at all. Anyway, so that'll be this episode. We now have the bismuth, so with that and the sphalerite, we can finally make ourselves some bronze and move into the Bronze Age, which I guess we'll do in the next episode. So I hope to see you back then. Have fun. Bye.